morning, everybody. Just grab your seats just a moment. Welcome, welcome. Thrilled that you found your way to our NG service. Really delighted that you're with us this morning. We believe that God is going to meet with us, encounter us, grow us, challenge, inspire us. We believe God is here already. Just some practical stuff. The kids will be released in about 20, 25 minutes or so. You will need a registration form to take the children to the different groups. So we've got creche, noughts to F1, we've got a group F2 to year 6, and we've got secondary school age. If you haven't got a registration form yet, you might want to just lift your hand now, and one of those will be brought to you by one of the stewards. Keep your hand up while we're doing that. You need to fill that in and take that to your group when the time is right. If there isn't quite a seat for you yet, when the kids go later, there'll be a seat, and so you can be part of that. I'm going to introduce Martin. Well, we'll introduce Martin a little bit later, and we're delighted that him and Esther are here this morning to come and deliver God's word for us. Let me start by reading from Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, my soul. Psalmist is having a word with himself there, isn't he? Praise the Lord, my soul. If you're having a great day, remind yourself this morning that you're going to celebrate him. If he's answered some prayers this week in your life, remind yourself that I'm going to bring my thanks for those answered prayers here in the house of God this morning. Maybe you're having a slightly tougher week. Well, remind yourself. Have a word with yourself. Praise the Lord, my soul. Praise the Lord, my soul. Forget not all his benefits, who forgives all our sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion. May you know God's love this morning. May you experience his compassion. May they be tangible. May they be real. May they be personal for you in the midst of everything that's going on. Because God satisfies your desires with good things. He's the one who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Shall we stand together? Lord, we praise you this morning. We exalt you this morning. We say there is no God like you. You're higher and above it all. And we bring you our sacrifice of praise. Let's celebrate God this morning.
Carry that. We're here to worship you. Together, I needed rescue.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen.
And when I was broken,
you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. Your holy name, I worship your holy name.
we lift our voices one more time. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. There's nobody like Jehovah. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Sing like never before. From your lips, just begin to magnify the name of the Lord. Somebody sing Him a new song in His presence. He's worthy, He's worthy, He's worthy. Worthy of all of our praises. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, He's worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised.
Our voices in this place one more time. We magnify You and we exalt You. You are the name above every name. You are the only one who's worthy of all of our praise. We declare again that You are great, that You, Jesus, are mighty, that You are powerful, all-powerful. And we exalt You, Jesus, our Savior and our Redeemer. The one who walked out of the tomb and has led us in the resurrection parade. We magnify You and worship You. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please take your seats. There'll be loads of chance to continue to worship later in our service. There's some seats right in the front here. If people are still looking for seats, you're most welcome to join us here. I'm going to talk about Bulgaria in a moment. We're going to take our first NG missions trip to Bulgaria next year, which I'm really excited about. So I'm going to introduce that in a bit. But many of you know, if you don't know me, sorry, I should have introduced myself. My name is John Fahey. It's my privilege to lead the NG Church Network. And many of you will know that we've been celebrating and supporting the King's Village in Ghana forever, for many years. And they themselves, Sarah and myself, had just got back from Ghana. They celebrated 20 years of ministry and transforming a community. And so here's a two-minute video. This is just 20 years of the King's Village.
This morning I woke up and I look in the mirror and every part of my body was in place. Many people died and never saw this day. So another day I live, I appreciate. Don't ever wanna act too high and mighty, cause tomorrow I can fall down on my face. So in everything, Lord, I give You praise. And that puts a smile on my face. Lord, I thank You for sunshine, thank You for rain, thank You for joy, thank You for pain. It's a beautiful day, beautiful day, it's a beautiful day, yeah. Don't fuss and fight, let us unite,
disappointment comes with a lesson.
It's for me to get wiser, got to work harder.
In the end, it will get better.
Lord, I thank you for sunshine, thank you for rain, thank you for joy, thank you for pain. It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day.
Please don't pass us by.
Let us unite.
Let us unite.
Drop the light, so let's make it right.
It's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
When we're there, we pass on our love and concern and prayers for them all the time. Listen, what we've been part of for the last 20 years in Ghana, we'd like to do something similar in Bulgaria starting this year. We'll put the offering slide up. Our offering today is all going to go to do with our new missions project in Bulgaria. We've been out three times this year to develop relationships with churches and individuals and ministries already happening. And we've picked two areas that we want to work with, both nearish Plovdiv, which is the middle of Bulgaria, and is with the Romani community. This is one of the poorest, marginalised, most impacted community in the whole of Europe. And with the links we've got there, we want to run kids camps, we want to impact a women's ministry that's happening, and we want to train churches over there as well. And so we're really excited about actually taking a team out from NG next summer. And so in a short while, I'll give you a chance to sign up for that, or you can sign up at the information point at the end of the service just to find out more information. But for now, what we'd like to do is just take our offering. So you can go on the QR code. If the stewards want to get ready with the offering bowls, we're going to do that now. So if you've got your camera, you want the QR card, do that now, because I'm going to show you another short video while that's going on. So you've got your QR codes. I'll put it up at the end of the service as well. But here's another video about Bulgaria.
Hold on. Hold on. Don't be scared. You'll never change what's been there. May your smile,
may your smile shine on,
shine on.
Don't be scared,
don't be scared.
Your destiny may keep you warm.
I'd love you to come to Ghana or Bulgaria with me next year if you want to. I can't take all of you, but we can take plenty of you. So we're going to be running trips, 1 year Bulgaria, 1 year Ghana. So every year there'll be a trip going to one of the two places. Next year we're going to do both, just to kick the Bulgaria thing off. It doesn't matter what your age you are. The Bulgaria mission in particular is much more affordable. And so those of you with families, why not come along as a family? Why not spend one summer, a couple of weeks in the summer, just instead of your usual holiday? You can go back to that next year. Come and be part of our trip to Bulgaria. I think it would really bless you and help you. If you sign up using the QR code or again at the information point, this isn't saying you're definitely coming. This is just you registering interest. If you've never thought about this sort of thing before, then maybe this is the morning you can decide. I fancy going on a short-term missions trip.
Let's be really real about this. This isn't about you going for 2 weeks and changing the world there. This is about you going for 2 weeks and encountering something new that will change you, but be part of a group of people that do this over decades. We can transform communities in other parts of the world. Our network can change and save lives in another part of the planet, and we believe we're called by God to do something. So I'd encourage you, be part of it. If you want to know more, again, you can message us and we'd give you loads and loads more details.
It's an honour for me to stand here and introduce someone. If you've been around for more than about 12 years, you will know that Martin and Esther belong to this community. So they were part of the Christian Centre for a lot of years, that was the mother church of this network in those years. But I don't want to introduce him as a son of this house. I had lots of introductions like that that were about short trousers and people who knew my father and all that stuff. Well, it made people really ready to hear the word of the Lord, didn't they? So a lot of years ago, a conversation that Martin and I had that I don't think I've ever spoken about. We were looking at the possibility of bigger buildings and how we could engage more people. And he said to me one day, well, why would any of us from our generation assume that we're going to have the grace to grow the size of congregations, of which there were only a few in this country that were the size of what the Christian Center was in those days? And I'm glad to say to you that the son of this house is a man of God who 11 and a half years ago with Esther went to Coventry and has seen something of the grace of God and has grown in this generation one of those churches. And I invite you to open your hearts and hear the word of the Lord from a man of God.
David, thank you so much. What an absolute joy to be with you. What an incredible gathering. This, you need a bigger building. And this is just so great and an absolute joy for Esther and myself to be with you. We're super conscious that there's a majority of you here in the room, never seen us, probably never heard of us. And yet, as David says, with others, there is history. I moved with my family to Nottingham when I was 11 years of age. At the age of 17, my family got ambushed. Oh, that, I wasn't expecting that to go up so soon. That's for those of you that remember us leaving with little kids. This is us now. But you can take that down now. I don't need to get distracted by that. What I wanted to say was, you know, I was 17, my family got ambushed by Jesus. My mum went to a meeting with a friend, didn't know anything about the Holy Spirit. She was baptized in the Holy Spirit without knowing what had happened to her. Knelt by her bed the next day to say the Lord's Prayer, which is all she really knew to do, and began speaking in tongues and didn't know what it was. Had to phone her friend, said, what on earth have you done to me? And that was the beginning, really, of us having a transformation in our family. And then pretty soon, we became part of Christian Center Nottingham, as was then. And then I went off to university, and in my first week got a visit from my Christian Union leader, who happened to be John Fahey. And amazing. So we met at university in Birmingham, and then I came back from university and was part of a leadership training school at the time under John Pettifer, who many of you will know. Where's John? John, why don't you just stand for us? This is, you know, John. So this is, can you still stand? Yeah, John. I was just checking John could still stand. He was, and on that year, Remy Anekwe, who leads Renaissance Church with Pearl, who's in Nigeria today, and Sarah Fahey, who leads Eagle Nest with John, and myself were part of that first cohort. So we have history. And it's an absolute joy for us to be back here today, and super delighted. I spent a lot of my early adult years in prayer and ministry for this incredible city of Nottingham. And, you know, some of you have been surprised if you knew us that I now have some gray hair, but I don't know if you expected me to be frozen in time. This is what happens. We get older. But today I want to turn to the Word of God. If you have a Bible, why don't you come with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 35. If you'd like a title for today, it's Back to Bethel. Back to Bethel. And what I'd like to do is set the scene here as you make your way to Genesis, chapter 35. I want to declare today that there is literally nothing more precious in my life than the presence of God, than the manifest presence of God. I'm not talking about the omnipresence of God. We understand that God is omnipresent, right? That he is everywhere. There's nowhere that he is not. Psalm 39 says it like this: where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. There's nowhere God is not. But there are times when he makes his presence felt, when we know that he is among us. There are times in our services in Coventry, because we are passionate about the presence of God. We are ruined for anything less than the presence of God. And I refuse to do a Christian life, which is a form of Christianity, where I don't engage with God himself. Because he has opened the door for that. The temple curtain is torn from top to bottom in order that we might come into his manifest presence. And sometimes I'll turn to Esther on the front row and I'll say, the Lord is here. And it's not that he wasn't here, it's that he has made his presence felt. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about today. Let me say, if you don't know what I'm talking about today, if you turn your heart towards him, if you set your heart to seek him, you will find him and you will know what I am talking about. But I'm guessing by the reaction in the room, most of us, we understand what it is to experience the manifest presence of the Holy Spirit. There is nothing more precious than that. Moments when the atmosphere changes, moments that in my life have transformed me, that I have been ruined from, like when Elijah throws his cloak onto Elisha and Elisha's life is ruined for anything less than the anointing, than the manifest presence of the Holy Spirit. There are some people coming to our services who are not used to church and begin to weep, and they don't know why they're weeping. The truth is, God is everywhere, but they didn't weep in Greg's. Because God wasn't manifest in Greg's, but when he manifests his presence, it changes us for everything. My connection with you here today is in many ways because of the presence of God. David Shearman, a spiritual father to me, who's just introduced me. When I was 17 and a brand new Christian, I was taken by a friend to a meeting in West Bridgeford, and he was the preacher on a Saturday or a Sunday night. I can't remember. It wasn't a regular Sunday morning service. And I didn't have the language for it then, but my spirit came alive. Something happened to me. It was the anointing on his life, the presence of God, and I was ruined for anything less. And I made my way to his church, and I sat on the back row because I just had to be near, if I could, to something that I'd experienced there. I hope you understand what I'm talking about today. And yet, it is my conviction that God doesn't want us just to visit those places, to have those moments occasionally. I thank God for moments. Who knows? We need moments, but we also need momentum. I can look back to those moments, the epiphanies, the encounters, the time when God appeared to me, as it were. And yet, my desire is not just to visit occasionally, but to dwell. And I believe that is God's desire for us too. And that's really what I'm talking about today, that we might move from occasional encounter to permanent habitation. If you're at Genesis 35, then we'll read 1 to 15. This is what the Bible says. Then God said to Jacob, go up to Bethel and settle there. Can we say settle there? Go up to Bethel and settle there. Build an altar there to God who appeared to you when you were fleeing from your brother Esau. So Jacob said to his household and all who were with him, get rid of your foreign gods you have with you and purify yourselves and change your clothes. Then come, let us go up to Bethel, where I will build an altar to God who answered me in the day of my distress and who has been with me wherever I have gone. So they gave Jacob all the foreign gods they had and the rings in their ears, and Jacob buried them under the oak at Shechem. Then they set out, and the terror of God fell on the towns all around them so that no one pursued them. Jacob and all the people with him came to Luz, that is Bethel in the land of Canaan. There he built an altar. And he called the place El Bethel because it was there that God revealed himself to him when he was fleeing from his brother. Now Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died and was buried under the oak outside Bethel. So it was named Alon Bakuth, the oak of weeping. After Jacob returned to Bethel from Paddan Aram, God appeared to him again and blessed him. And God said to him, your name is Jacob, but you will no longer be called Jacob. Your name will be Israel. So he named him Israel. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and increase in number. A nation and a community of nations will come from you. And kings will be among your descendants. The land I gave Abraham and Isaac, I also give to you. And I will give this land to your descendants after you. Then God went up from him at the place where he had talked with him. Jacob set a stone pillar at the place where God had talked to him, and he poured out a drink offering on it. He also poured oil on it. Jacob called the place where God had talked with him Bethel. You might wonder what this story has to do with us in 2023. Let me say a couple of things about that. Firstly, the New Testament tells us in 1 Corinthians 10 and in Romans 15 verse 4 that the stories of the Old Testament are recorded for us and written down for us as warnings and as encouragements that we might understand the ways of God. And so we look at these stories not purely as history, but to glean what are they saying to us today. And I believe God will be saying something to us today from this story. And secondly, this story will make no sense to us if we don't understand what Bethel was to Jacob. Bethel was Jacob's place of encounter. Most of you will know the Bible well enough to know that in chapter 28 of Genesis, Jacob is fleeing from his brother Esau, who has threatened to kill him because Jacob's just stolen Esau's birthright. And while he is fleeing, he's on the run. The Bible tells us he came to what is described as a certain place. I think a nondescript place. It just happened to be the place where he was. But as he laid his head down to sleep that night, God appeared to him. And appeared to him so powerfully and dramatically that he got up in the morning and he said, how awesome is this place? This is nothing other than the house of God. God was in this place and I didn't even know it. And he called it Bethel, which means the house of God. And later on in chapter 32, God appears to Jacob again in a dream, and God announces himself as something he doesn't call himself in any other place in the Bible. He says, I am the God of Bethel. What is he saying to Jacob? He's saying, do you remember when we met? I am he who met you in that place. I am the God of Bethel. Bethel was Jacob's place of encounter. It was the place where he met God. It was the place where his life had been changed. It's the place. And he says here to those that are with him, God has been with me all of my life. And yet in those moments, he knows Bethel is a special place. It's the place where he encountered God. And here God is saying to him, will you go to Bethel and settle there? Will you live in a place of encounter? Will you dwell in the place of my presence? Will you allow for us, 2023, that we might not just visit the manifest presence of the Holy Spirit from time to time, but would we be dwellers in the presence of the Holy Spirit? And I'd like us to take note of a few things here this morning. Firstly, I'd like us to take note of the fact there is an invitation. It's actually an instruction. It's a command. Go to Bethel and settle there. But my point is that it wasn't Jacob saying to God, can I go to Bethel again? It was God saying to Jacob, I want you to go to Bethel. And as much as we might desire to be in the presence of God, I believe God himself desires us to be in that place. The Holy Spirit, he is longing for us to come to him and to dwell. And in my experience, when I make room for him, he comes. Jeremiah 29, you will find me when you seek me, when you seek me with all of your heart. But there is an invitation. There's an invitation by the way of the cross. But I believe it is God's desire that we would dwell with him. The way is made open that we would approach the throne of grace with confidence. This is the desire of God. The Hebrew word veseb, to settle, where God says to him, would you go to Bethel and Veseb there? Would you dwell? Would you remain? Would you live? Would you put your roots down? Don't longer just visit, but would you stay at Bethel? I thank God for those moments. But we have to learn to be dwellers in the presence of God. We have to learn to be those that will tabernacle with God in the place of the Holy Spirit, that we might come back to Bethel and dwell there. I remember coming back from university here to Nottingham as part of this leadership training school and beginning a journey of learning to dwell in the presence of God. Learning to get up early and to seek God and to be in the Word and to change my playlist and to listen to worship and to get to the place where I could just speak His name, the name of Jesus, and sense His presence. I remember having some profound encounters in that season, probably a three-month period, where I dwelt in the presence of the Holy Spirit for the first time, a sustained period in my life. I remember having a powerful encounter in the pastor aisle in Asda. I was working in Asda in my afternoons, and as I just started to worship in that place, stacking shelves, to worship You, I live. To worship You, I live, I live. And the presence of God fell in the pastor aisle. I kid you not. But will we be dwellers in the presence? Will we seek to settle there? I believe there is an invitation for us. I believe it is the desire of God. God says to him, go back to Bethel and settle there and build an altar there. There's much we could say about altars, but one thing that I have come to understand about altars, they are a place of reciprocation. They are not merely a place of sacrifice. They are a place of sacrifice. They are a place of worship. The altars in our lives, the altars in our hearts, that we would build an altar before the Lord and we come as worshipers to respond to what He has already done for us. And yet in my experience, when we do that, He comes and encounters us. We put our offering on the altar and He brings fire upon it and we encounter something of Him. And then we worship Him all the more and He encounters us all the more. Altars are a place not just that we bring something to say thank You, but where we meet with Him. And He's saying here to Jacob, go back to Bethel, settle there and make it a place of an altar that I might be with You and dwell with You. This is an invitation for you today. It is an invitation. I understand it. I don't know. Maybe you love these times together. It can be strange for all of us when we come out of our normal routine, but I believe there is an invitation to you today to take a step, to make a heart response. Also want us to notice there's a cost. You could call it a response or a preparation or a consecration or a purification, but do you notice that when God says to Jacob, will you go back to Bethel and settle there and build an altar? Jacob turns to all the people and said, we've got to deal with some stuff. He says, get rid of your foreign idols. Change your clothes. Purify yourselves. Wow. I remember reading this earlier this year, and I'd never seen this before. Being impacted that Jacob, who says, this is the God who has been with me all of my life, and yet in that season where he's not in the place of God's presence, even though God has been with him and we can live as Christians and God is with us, and yet there are things we allow in our lives, but he knows that if they're going to Bethel, they need to sort some stuff out. And they deal with their stuff. They tolerated certain things. They tolerated idols in their midst. Jacob had tolerated idols in their midst. But if they're going to be dwellers in the presence, he knows they have to get rid of these things. They have to deal with. See, we don't have any idols, do we? We don't have any foreign gods. We're only careers and houses and cars and reputations and phones that we can't put down. Hello? They had to get rid of some things. They had to change some things. They had to remove some things. Sometimes in our lives we can have what I think we might understand as, to us, acceptable sin, if I can say it like that. Not acceptable to God, but somehow, somewhere within our lives or our psyche, there are some things that we know are not ideal, but we don't even repent of them anymore. We allow them to coexist within our walk with God. We might not want our pastors to know or our life group leaders, small group leaders to know, or our praying mothers to know. And if we're going to be dwellers in the presence, I have come to believe I need to deal with these things. Oh, hear me right. It's all by grace. It's all by grace. I can't earn anything. But if I'm going to be a dweller in the presence of God, it's appropriate that I consecrate my life. And there might be some things I have to put aside. There might be some things, if I'm taking a step, that I have to deal with. Remember the first time, which was when I was here in Nottingham, part of the ministry at Christian Center, doing my first full food fast for 21 days. And towards the end of that time, I had a powerful encounter with God. If I've ever heard God speak, it was on that day. And I remember I was on this little lean-to. I'd call it a lean-to. It wasn't a conservatory. You could have pushed it over and it would have collapsed. But it was where I was on that day, on my knees seeking God. And I felt the Holy Spirit say, Martin, will you be obscure for me? Now, you've got to understand, at that time I was in ministry, I believe there was a call on my life to Christian leadership and to preach. The Holy Spirit, will you be obscure for me? Will you be hidden? Will you be where no one knows who you are and no one sees you? I remember saying, God, why would you want me to be obscure when you've spoken these words over my life? And he said, will you be obscure for me? I remember wrestling. I literally thought my life was going to change. I saw myself working as a carer in my mind's eye, serving somebody in a wheelchair, just being hidden, a change of life. I remember wrestling, thinking, God, I'd be terrible at that anyway. The truth is, I would have been. But I felt he was asking me, he was calling me to obscurity, and I don't know. It felt like an eternity. It was probably 20 minutes. But I remember coming to a place on my knees of saying, God, if you want me to be obscure for me, if you will go with me, I will be obscure for you. I'd no longer caught my breath than the Holy Spirit said, will you be prominent for me? Let me tell you, if you've ever embraced obscurity, the ugliest thing on the planet is prominence. I was like, no, I'm good with obscurity. Like, seriously, I don't want to be prominent. Why would I want to be prominent? I don't want to be talked about over Sunday lunch. I don't want my kids in the spotlight. Lord, I am good with obscurity. I'm like, Lord, send Ali Kent. It's like, let's seriously. It's like I don't need this. So will you be prominent for me? I remember reaching the same place of saying, God, if you go with me, I'd be prominent for you. And I hadn't caught my breath. And I felt the Holy Spirit say, will you give me your house? Now, we lived in a 3-bedroom semi. It wasn't much to write home about. And I didn't think it meant anything to me until the Holy Spirit came and asked me for it. And I was like, Lord, give me a break. Go and pick on John Fahey. I'm like, seriously, like, why? Will you give me your house? And I honestly thought we might need to sell our house and any equity that was there, give it away. I remember saying, Lord, you can have everything. You can have my house. He was checking me for foreign gods because he was taking me into a new season of dwelling in his presence. I want to tell you this. There will be a cost. I've found to be a presence dweller. I have to walk in holiness, commit to humility, embrace repentance, refuse unforgiveness in my life, go after consecration. They change their clothes. It can be like a reset. There's some things we maybe need to do. Maybe some things that are on us. Like Gilgal in Joshua 5. Maybe some things of the past that are on us and we can't even see that they're on us. They change their clothes. They purified themselves and they set out for Bethel. Thirdly, there's a journey. You might feel daunted, but I want you to be encouraged today. They set out. You know, sometimes we can come to these moments and go, I know myself too well. I have tried a reset before. But all we can ever do is set out. All we can ever do is begin. But the Bible says when they set out, the fear of God descended on all the surrounding towns. So no one touched their journey. And in my experience, I've had my fair share of battles and challenges and opposition, like I'm sure you have. But whenever I've set my heart to seek God, nothing's ever got in the way other than my own flesh. God will protect your walk if you want to be a presence dweller. He will watch over you. But do you also notice earlier in his life that Jacob, he has sought God and he has found God alone. The first time in Bethel is an encounter by himself. Just a couple of chapters earlier, he's there and he sends everyone ahead of him when he's going to go and be reunited with Esau. He wants to be alone and he wrestles with God and he encounters God and he's blessed by God. But here God says, will you settle at Bethel? And he had to go with others. And I've come to know that if I'm really going to be a presence dweller, I need others in my life. I need others that are also trying to seek after God and live in the presence of the Holy Spirit, who are trying to dwell as the people of the Spirit. My friends, we are the people of the Holy Spirit. It is our distinctive, isn't it? What? How else are we going to reach Nottingham? How else are we going to transform lives? How else is the light of Christ going to shine through us if not by the power of the Holy Spirit? But we need each other. If we're going to make a significant journey, we need each other. We need brothers and sisters around us that we can pray with, that can help us, that can lift us up, that where we can spur one another on. The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so one will sharpen another. I thank God for the brothers with whom I can pray, with whom I can seek after God, who have are trying to live consecrated lives. There is a journey. But let me also encourage us that there is an impact. Drew, why don't you come and join me? There's an impact. There's a consequence. You know, Jacob sets out for Bethel, and when he gets there, the Bible says God appeared to him. Can we say appeared? God appeared to him. He said, Jacob, will you go back to Bethel and settle there? And when he got there, God appeared to him. He met him there. When we set our hearts and we set out, God will meet us. Let me tell you, you will never set your heart to be in the presence of God and him not show up for you. And him not come. His heart is to meet with us. The Bible tells us that he blessed Jacob. Those who hunger and thirst will be satisfied. There have been those times in my life, I'm sure like you, where I've needed God to speak and the heavens have been like brass. There have been seasons where I haven't known where God is. But you know, when I've set my heart to be in his presence, sooner or later, I have always encountered him. Do you notice also that the Lord changes Jacob's name? He says, you've been called Jacob, but you're no longer going to be called Jacob. It's in the presence of God that we understand who we are, that our identity changes. It's not the first time he said this. This is actually the second time he said it to him, but he says it to him again. He says, from now on, you'll be called Israel. He'd been called Jacob because it means grasped at the heel, deceiver, because he'd come out of the womb holding on literally to his brother's heel. And then he lived a life of deceiving and being deceived. But Israel, comes out that moment where he wrestled with God, and really it means triumphant with God. And he says, you're not going to be called deceiver anymore. You're going to be called triumphant with God. Some of us, we've allowed names to be on us. Maybe things that have been spoken over us and we've internally reinforced them. We've spoken them over ourselves. And in his presence, he'll say, that's not your name. That's not who you are. We'll understand that we are something else. In the presence of God, Jacob has a personal revelation. I love it. God says, I am God Almighty. And we could read it and think it means nothing. But he says to him that God Almighty, the Hebrew is El Shaddai. I am El Shaddai. What we've got to understand is that El Shaddai is the name, the all-sufficient one. It's the name that God revealed to Abraham, his granddad. He appeared to Abraham and he said, I am El Shaddai. I am the all-sufficient one. And Jacob would have heard the name. He knew the name because grandpa had heard El Shaddai. When he's about to leave the house because Esau is going to kill him, his father, Isaac, he reaches out to him and he says, may El Shaddai bless you. His dad knew El Shaddai. And he comes to Bethel. And now God says to Jacob, I'm El Shaddai. He reveals himself personally. Who knows, there are no grandchildren in the kingdom of God, only sons and daughters in every generation. If we will dwell in his presence, we'll have our own revelation. I thank God for the revelation of my fathers. Some of us, we've grown up in Christian homes, and thank God for a Christian upbringing. Some of us, we've come to know who God is because we've served under men or women of God, and they've helped us understand. But you know, God really wants to reveal himself to us, that we wouldn't just know he's El Shaddai because someone else told us he was El Shaddai, but because he comes and says, I'm El Shaddai, and I'm all sufficient to you. And he comes and he promises him. He promises him influence and increase. He says, go and you will increase. You will have nations and communities of nations. He says, kings are going to come out of you. Not your father or your father's father, Jacob. You're going to be a man of influence. And he promises him the land that he promised to Abraham and to Isaac. Oh, God wants to use our lives. Does anyone believe God wants to use our lives? I profoundly believe God wants to use your life. But the key to our influence, the key to our promise, the connection to our destiny, is going to be found in the presence of the Almighty. I know John and the team have engineered today and front-loaded the service so we could have time to respond. I wonder if the band, Dex and the band, would you come and join us? I want to invite you as the band come onto the platform just to consider your own heart today. To understand there's an invitation to you to respond. To be a presence dweller. To be someone that settles in the presence of the Holy Spirit. I don't know, I've had seasons of my life where just the busyness of life, even as a minister of the gospel, not even battling with a marketplace job and the demands of life, as a minister of the gospel, I've been so busy, I've drifted. But I've come to places and moments like this, and I've said, God, I must be in your presence. I need you, and I desire you. I'm going to invite us to make a response here today, to respond to the word that the Lord may be speaking to you. If he's coming and drawing you and saying, will you come closer? Will you draw near? Some of us, I'm going to invite us in a moment to stand, and for some of us to step out of our seats. And it might get messy, and to come here down the front. Why? Because I think they set out, and I think something important happens when we set out. When we physically take a step, we say, God, I'm coming after you. I want to be a presence dweller. I want to settle in the presence of the Holy Spirit. I want to get up in the morning and sense that you're with me. I don't want to go from Sunday to Sunday, or from month to month, or season to season, or even year to year. I want to know that you're with me. I want my house and my home to be like Obed-Edom's, where the presence of God dwells. I need you, Holy Spirit, in my life to be empowered for witness. Some of us, we might have idols or things or distractions or habits or just some stuff where today we can come and say, God, let this be a Shechem, a place where I bury some stuff that has not been helping me. Friends, can we stand together?
As the NG Church Network, we are passionate about seeing the entire region of Greater Nottingham and the surrounding villages transformed by the Kingdom of God.
We're a network of churches that exist to inspire, and pioneer healthy, flourishing churches of all sizes across the NG postcodes.
All the NG churches share these values. Jesus is central, and we exist to glorify him. We are Holy Spirit filled. Everyone can experience God's love and power.
We transform our communities by serving our communities through kids clubs, food banks, toddler groups, youth events, and so much more.
As a real working apostolic network, we cheer one another on. We train and support our leaders. We want every leader to reach their God-given potential.
We worship together in our joint services. And as we worship, we release God's power and blessing all over our city.
We share resources to support mission projects in Ghana and Bulgaria and other parts of the world. We are a local network with a global heart.
We are convinced that the kingdom-minded leaders with broken yet redeemed hearts, passionate for our city and working together in genuine friendship and unity is the way to see God break into our city in a new and exciting way.
We believe Jesus is still declaring good news. He's still freeing trapped people, still opening blind eyes, and still liberating the oppressed. And we are fully engaged in serving him.